Is modern art schizophrenic? I didn't know what to title this video due to it probably being a controversial topic, but the intent of this video is not to place value judgment on any art, but to explain how the divided brain has contributed to our understanding of the world and how we view it. The theory I am about to describe is that which has been studied by some very influential and highly accredited psychologists, such as Dr. Ian McGilchrist in his book The Master and His Emissary, and Lewis Sass in his book Modernism and Madness. Both two books that have been revolutionary and extremely influential in the fields of psychology, neuropsychology, and sociology. Most of this video is heavily influenced by these writings of these two psychologists, so links to their books and works will be in the description of the video. The argument that both of these books represent is, in simple terms, is the following: that through psychological development and evolution as a species, we have developed an over-reliance for the left hemisphere and its modes of apprehension towards the world, most predominantly in the West, and how this way of understanding the world mirrors the phenomenology of schizophrenia. By observing its relative symptoms and its induced experiences, which are dominated mostly through the left hemisphere, we can analyse the progression of art through modernism and postmodernism to provide adequate evidence for such a theory using the relative scientific literature. To begin this video, I want to explain and give a brief introduction to how we got to the point where we are today, and what fundamentally acted for such a change towards strict left hemisphere apprehension. This especially relates to why art has progressed the way it has over the past 200 to 300 years through these transitions of societal history. Social disintegration derived from the Industrial Revolution and Enlightenment's quest for the ideal society. Through this process of dramatic change in Western culture, strict fundamental paradigms were ripped out in a very short period of time. Processes that occurred within the change to modernity were rural to urban. The Enlightenment led to a breakdown of familiar social structures and loss of a sense of belonging. The advances of scientific materialism on one hand and bureaucracy on the other, which knowingly helped what Weber called the disenchanted world. Capitalism and consumerism also emerged, which led ways of conceiving human relationships based on little more than utility, greed, and competition. Effects of abstraction, bureaucratization, and social dislocation on personal identity were strong themes in sociology, with the intent to truly understand their effects on consciousness since the likes of Max Weber and Emil Durkheim. Works such as these were further explored in books like The Homeless Mind by Peter Berger, for example. It can be seen that pervasive, rationalistic, technical, and bureaucratic ways of thinking slowly emptied life of meaning by destroying what Berger called the sacred canopy of meanings, reflecting collective beliefs about life, death, and the world in which we live. The result of which Durkheim famously called anomy, or loss of all bearings, the demise of any shared structure of values, leading to further existential angst towards existence. In further sociological works, the famous sociologist Anthony Giddens identified and describes the characteristic disruption of space and time acquired by globalization, itself the necessary consequence of industrial capitalism, which destroys the sense of belonging and ultimately of individual identity, something he calls disembedded mechanisms, which do, when in effect, separate things from their context and ourselves from the uniqueness of a place or what he calls locale. Media also does this on a larger scale, producing random juxtaposition of items of information and also permit the intrusion of distant events in everyday consciousness, which is another example of decontextualization in modern life, adding to loss of meaning in the experienced world. Further adaptions in society develop with an extreme pace of change in the physical environment, all fueled by consumption. The need for convenient transport, exploitation of the natural world, turning agriculture into a business, increasing urbanization, all resulting in a very common theme which is the key to this video, which is that of alienation and the fragmentation of social bonds within communities. Thus our attachments, which ultimately give our lives meaning, all come to be disrupted. Ultimately, what occurs to develop in the world of Western modernity go far more deeper and wider than what has manifested in art. So what are some of the most distinct differences between the left and right hemisphere? The right hemisphere plays a vital role in emotional expression via the face or the voice. The right frontal lobe is of critical importance for emotional expression from voice to body posture, except for the emotion of anger, which is connected to the left frontal lobe, mostly due to dopamine connections. Autistic children, for example, who cannot understand social language, irony and metaphor, and lack capacity for empathy, all mediated by the right frontal region, lack prosodic skill and the ability to convey meaning and feeling through voice intonation. The left hemisphere is involved in some emotional presentation, but is much more artificial, such as willed or forced emotional expression. But when compared to the right, it is very much neutral, as the right focuses on primary process emotionality. The left hemisphere, being believed to have the complete monopoly on reason, is mistaken. Reasoning of the linear, sequential kind is better executed by the left hemisphere, but deduction and mathematical reasoning are mainly dependent on the right hemisphere. There is also evidence that mathematical skill are divided between the hemispheres, but arithmetic calculations and general mathematical calculation play a strong role in the right hemisphere. The right hemisphere sees nothing in the abstract, but always appreciates things in their context. It is interested in the personal, by contrast with the left hemisphere, which has more affinity for the abstract or impersonal. The right hemisphere sees things as a whole before they have been digested into parts, and because of this, sees things in its own context, standing in a qualifying relationship with all that surrounds it, rather than taking it as a single isolated entity. The link between the right hemisphere and holistic or gestalt perception is one of the most reliable and durable of generalizations about hemisphere differences. Due to the right hemisphere's holistic processing of visual form, it is not based on summation of parts. On the other hand, the left hemisphere sees the part objects from a crowd of dots and splashes, for example. In relation to this, people with unilateral brain damage show complementary deficits in drawing skills, depending on whether it is the right or left hemisphere that is compromised. For example, those with right hemisphere damage rely on their left hemisphere and lose overall coherence and integrity, and become so distorted that they are barely recognizable. There is no grasp of the gestalt or the whole. For example, one patient is asked to draw an elephant, but only draws a tail, a trunk, and an ear in fragmented fashion. So, with a quick glaze over the major differences between the two hemispheres, I want to get into the schizophrenic symptoms and experiences which can appear when the right hemisphere is damaged. When this happens, we see a range of clinically similar problems to those found in a schizophrenic. These are 1. A lack in understanding context, problems with pragmatics, a lacking understanding tone, a poor ability to interpret facial expression, poor ability to express and interpret emotion, poor ability in understanding presupposition of another person's point of view, difficulty in gestalt perception and grasping or understanding wholes, poor intuitive processing, a lacking understanding metaphor, appreciating narrative, a poor sense of the natural flow of time, a deficient sense of reality or substantiality of experiences, same for events or persons, for example, thinking that everything all is nothing but play acting, a narrowly focused attention with over-intellectualizing its specifics, with it being inappropriately deliberate in approach, a reliance of decontextualized analysis, then being intuitive, spontaneous, or having a global mode of apprehension, and finally, everything seen with a strong glance of utilitarianism. From neuroimaging, there is also evidence that schizophrenics show abnormal activation in situations where one would expect more activation in the right hemisphere. For example, sense of smell abnormally is lateralized with a decrease in right hemisphere activation in limbic connections to the rhinencephalon and right orbitofrontal cortex, which is in layman's terms the smell brain. This is not insignificant when seeing how critical sense of smell is for infant-mother bonding, social bonding, which plays part in grounding our world in intuition and the body. It also happens to be that drugs that help stabilize schizophrenia act to reduce dopaminergic activity, which is a form of neurotransmission, which by the way is more dependent on the left hemisphere to a greater extent than that of the right. So in contrast, there are these remarkable similarities between individuals with schizophrenia and those whose right hemisphere is not functioning normally. If this is what happens in individuals, could a culture dominated by left hemisphere modes of apprehension begin to exhibit such features? Well, there is striking correlation for precisely that. Lewis Sass, the influential psychologist and author of the book Madness and Modernism, has written widely about the culture of modernism, its art, its writings, and its philosophy, in connection with the phenomenology of schizophrenia. Sass draws on a multitude of closely argued parallels between experiences of schizophrenics and the world picture of modernism and postmodernism. This purpose is not to pass a value judgment, but simply to point out the parallels in the literature, visual arts, and critical discourse about art in this era in relation to schizophrenia. What Sass picks up on in modern culture by identifying schizophrenia may in fact be the over-reliance of the left hemisphere in the West. Schizophrenia ultimately boils down to symptoms and experiences relating to a group of core disturbances in the relation between the self and the external world. Sass calls that the most important one is that of what he calls hyperconsciousness. This is where elements of the self and of experience, which should and need to remain intuitive and unconscious, become objects of a detached, alienated attention. Levels of consciousness multiply so that there is an awareness of one's own awareness, for example. This can lead to an inability to trust one's own body or one's own intuitions, and everything gets dragged into the full glare of consciousness. Associated with this is what Sass calls a loss of ipsiety, or in other words, a loss in the pre-reflective, grounding sense of the self, or of individual identity. This self has to be constructed from the products of observation. Its existence comes into doubt, gives rise to reflexivity whereby attention is focused on the self and its body, so that parts of the self come to appear alien. There is a loss of the pre-reflective sense of the body as something living and lived, and a loss of the immediate physical and emotional experience which grounds us in the world. Now, these two symptoms and experiences of schizophrenia, of what Sass calls hyperconsciousness and loss of ipsiety, represent two opposite positions. Hyperconsciousness is very much the same as omnipotence, whereby all the elements of the self are given alienated attention, even awareness itself is given attention. But loss of ipsiety is very much the same as impotence, a loss in the grounding sense of the self, therefore the self is constructed from products of observation. McGilchrist writes the following in his book The Master and His Emissary: "There is a veering between the two apparently opposite positions, which are in reality aspects of the same position, omnipotence and impotence. Either there is no self, which is the hyperconsciousness element, or all that the observing eye sees is in fact part of the self, with the corollary that there is no world apart from the self, which is the loss of ipsiety element. Whether there is no self or everything is embraced in the self, the result is the same, since both conditions lack the normal sense we have of ourselves as defined by an awareness that there exists something apart from ourselves. This position is associated in schizophrenia with a subjectivization of experience, a withdrawal from the external world and a turning of attention inwards towards a realm of fantasy. The world comes to lack those characteristics, the ultimate unknowability of aspects of the world that exceed our grasp, and the recalitrance of a realm separate from our fantasy. That suggests a reality that exists apart from our will. At the same time, the world and the people in it are objectified, become objects. In a term borrowed from Heidegger, Sass sees an unwelding of the world, which becomes fragmented and lacking meaning. Hyperconsciousness, loss of ipsiety, and so-called unwelding are fundamental to the experiences of subjects with schizophrenia. The disintegrated stare that Wittgenstein noticed is characteristic of schizophrenia. Sass writes the following: "Persons in the schizophrenia spectrum often seem to move in on the stimulus field in the sense of engaging in a kind of fixed, penetrated, over-focused stare that dissolves the more commonly recognized gestalts in favor of their component parts. This is also a feature of modernism, and something that is invited into the realms of conscious perception, which has the effect of bringing about willfully the fragmented world of the left hemisphere. Suzanne Sontag alluded to this in that it is the mode of consciousness that is positively invited in by the viewer of modernist art. As I quote, traditional art invokes a look, modernist art engenders a stare. but instead, this stare suggests alienation, either a need for control or a feeling of a terrified helplessness. This stare, so to speak, is not known for building bridges with others or with the world at large. Sass points to a dehumanization, a disappearance of the active self in modernism. There is, in replacement, a certain fragmentation and passivization, a loss of the self's unity and capacity for effective action. It is either an impersonal subjectivism or alternatively the most extreme kind of objectivism. Refusing all empathy, stripping the world of value, Sass alludes to Robe Grillet's The Secret Room, where such a supposed story consists of a series of static descriptions of a woman's corpse. Its cold, clinical detachment expresses better than any purely abstract art the triumph of alienation over natural human feeling. Such stories in literature and many others are carefully compared by Sass, which show characteristic schizophrenic discourse in literature as well as the arts. Disruption of narrative with formal devices drawing attention away from the inherent temporality of language empties human action and intention of the meaning they have in a world to which we respond and which responds to us. All coupled with the forcible alienation caused by the bringing into awareness of that is required to remain latent, results in a detachment and irony that are harmful to pathos, emotion and passion. McGilchrist says the following: if one has to sum up these features of modernism, they could probably be reduced to these: an excess of consciousness and an over-explicitness in relation to what needs to remain intuitive and implicit, depersonalization and alienation from the body and empathic feeling, disruption of context, fragmentation of experience, and the loss of betweenness. They are aspects of a single world, not just the world of the schizophrenic, but, as may by now be clear, the world according to the left hemisphere. The problem with the strict, unstable alternation between subjectivism and objectivism that Sass identifies in modernism is what you could call a derealization or an unworlding of the world, just as the same in schizophrenia. The world is either robbed of substantiality and ontological status, of that being independent from its perceiving subject, or on the flip side, the world is seen as alien, devoid of human resonance and or significance. Instead of one consistent viewpoint, there arises an obvious perspectivism or relativism from this, such as moral relativism, which grew back into interest during the 20th century. An uncertainty and multiplicity of viewpoints, this has the effect of either, on one hand, drawing attention to the presence of a particular perspective which displays a recognition of its limitedness, or alternatively attempting to transcend such limits by inhabiting a variety of perspectives. This goes with the belief that there is no true world, because everything is, as Nietzsche famously said, but a perspectival appearance whose origin lies in us. Even though this is something Nietzsche recognized in the modern mind, he did not welcome it at all. In fact, he dreaded its consequences, speaking of the great bloodsucker, the spider skepticism, and warning that our excessive self-consciousness will ultimately destroy us. Sass calls what there is an aesthetic self-referentiality in modernism, where the work of art becomes, I quote, a form of drama in which consciousness watches itself in action. Now pay close attention to this, this is quite an interesting observation. This is where the art is emptied of external attachments or of representational content, so that the formal content becomes the focus in the work. For example, purely abstract art, or something that lacks an external representative from itself. Or, there is an exploiting of representational or narrative conventions self-consciously without context, so that they themselves become the focus of the work. For example, these types of so-called art sculptures or pieces whereby there is an extreme exploitation of conventional, ordinary, usual items with no context whatsoever. In other words, there is a shift of attention to the surface, whether on canvas, for example, Greenberg's famous flatness of modernism art, or in written medium. Schizophrenics experience precisely a loss of visual depth, in some cases describing the external world, as like a two-dimensional transparency. All in all, attention is focused on the medium and not the world beyond the medium, which is effectively denied, mirroring the tropes of postmodern literature, which undercuts the possibility of existence beyond language. Michael Gazzaniger has referred to the left hemisphere as the interpreter, the locus of self-consciousness, of conscious volition, and of rationality, which since the Enlightenment we have seen as being our defining qualities as human beings. An interpreter in this case is not an originator, but a facilitator and should be involved in mediating between the parties. The more we rely on the left hemisphere, the more self-conscious we become. The intuitive, unconscious, unspoken elements of experience are relatively discounted, and the interpreter begins to interpret itself. The world it puts into words for us is the world that words themselves have created. The condition is lonely, self-wrapped. The left hemisphere has isolated itself from the ways of the right hemisphere and has lost access to the world beyond words, and the world beyond ourselves. Man keeps getting into the picture, as Heidegger says, of the modern era. Aestheticism emerged at the end of the 19th century, which has been seen as flowerings of Romanticism. By now no longer fruitful, Romanticism has expired and has replaced by counter-romantic, distancing ironies of absurdism and the Dadaist movement, and by the beginnings of modernism, predominantly in France and Russia. Time-expired ideas embodied in a culture are overthrown by the new yet more vigorous growth of an opposing movement, a more defiant slip in the balance of the hemispheres. Aestheticism was an extension of the self-consciousness of Victorian art and a precursor of the self-consciousness of modernism, yet faculty of imagination was set to lay motionless. The left hemisphere creates newness by recombining in a novel fashion what is already known, not as imagination does, which allows something that we thought to be new to be truly revealed for the first time in art. A good analogy of this functioning is when you see a children's book which is split into three, whereby you can invent a new animal by putting the head of a hippo with the body of a lion and legs of a rhino, thus producing in this sense the novelty of the artificial, the bizarre, the unnatural, and the obscure. The creed of art for art's sake, which it sounds from first hearing like an elevation of the value of art, in that it denies it should have an ulterior purpose beyond itself, which is great, but also at the same time is a devaluation of art, in that it marginalizes its relationship with the life itself. In other words, the term sacrifices the betweenness of art with life. In all cases with artwork, we see two carried beyond the work of art, precisely because the artist was not focused on the art as such, but in something beyond it, which is what makes art so great. Advances in modernism brought further self-conscious art, developing further problems of alienation, fragmentation, and decontextualization. The defining features of the modern world were as problematic for art as they were for society, since art, like society, derives its meaning and power from connection, cohesion, and context. Many artists saw the modern world turning and thus, in response to this dilemma, tended to diverge. It can be well argued that a work of art is more like a living being than a thing, and that our encounter with that being matters and means something completely depends on the fact that any living being is in itself whole and engaged. If it is itself experienced as fragmented, incoherent, and decontextualized, it ceases to exist. The same is for art, as it becomes merely opaque, as the art no longer succeeds in telling us or letting us see the world anew, but forces itself as the focus of our attention with very little to tell or say. Some diamonds in the rough of this era are Egon Schiele and Stanley Spencer, who grappled with this conundrum and were impelled to produce truly imaginative, intuitive solutions. You could say artistic virtuosos such as Picasso, Matisse, Stravinsky, and Schoenberg more or less move uneasily between these positions. At times, through intuition, some of their works sweep away the precepts of modernism itself. In the book Master and His Emissary by McGilchrist, he outlines why he believes very few artists have escaped from modernism and all of its faculties previously mentioned. He sees two fundamental tendencies in the criticism of modernism. One, a willingness to accept an explicit manifesto or message as a substitute for imaginative experience. This is often an apparently coded message which thereby flatters the decoder of the art or the person inspecting and viewing it. He goes on to write that we have art where there is nothing more than a piece of text, as to give for a quick example, but the second tendency complements the first, which is 2. In the absence of a message, we tend to stare at it until it is freighted with meaning. Tristan Zara, one of the founders of that mess called Dadaism, rather gave the game away when he proclaimed at the outset of modernism that art had become a private affair. The artist produces it for himself or herself, and judgment has become completely subjective. Malevich, in 1913, exhibited his black square, in 1915, his black circle, and in 1917, his white square. He was, of course, making a statement, though using art to make a statement is itself another aspect of the left hemisphere, especially when there is no artistic qualities in the so-called art to make a statement. The Enlightenment, the rise of man over nature, the glorified power of the sciences, the rise of technology, the outpouring of exaltation towards the sheer power of the human will, and in our power to shape our destiny. With this said, it may not be by accident that the age of modernism also saw the rise of totalitarian ideology in Russia, Germany, and Italy. The modernism of the Nazi regime was unmistakable in cultural adventurism, political extremism, and the uncompromising shredding of the past. Yet of course not all modernist art leads to such things, obviously, but as McGilchrist says, one can surely agree with Virilio that the unanchored representation of reality as art, however dislocated or disturbing, an extension of the aesthetic creed, art for art's sake, which is endemic in modernism, is part of much more profound failures of compassion and an erosion of pity. Lenin himself supposedly reported to have said the following: "I'm not good at art. Art for me is something like an intellectual appendix. And when its use as propaganda, which we need at the moment, is over, we shall cut it out as useless. Snip, snip." According to Martin Sixsmith, suicide was a very common outcome for poets and writers years after 1917. With the Kremlin's bent on whipping out originality, and with imagination no longer needed or welcome, later the Nazis and Stalinists discouraged imagination, which they saw as decadent and useless, and with Lenin's regime, glorified art only where it might have a political purpose or ideological basis. All the good reason for not understanding why, for example, Jordan Peterson has Soviet art all over his house of Lenin when he supposedly hates Marxism and socialism. Why would you smother your house in art that is made to be deceitful to the viewer, veiling ideology behind artistic propaganda which you supposedly hate? Moving on, let's look at some art genres from modern and postmodern era that especially prioritize the left hemisphere. Cubism. This art form replaced subtle softness of textured living surfaces, exactly what we need our right temporoparietal regions to interpret, by dislocated abstracted surfaces, composed of rectilinear shapes represented from a multitude of viewpoints intersecting randomly and destroying any sense of depth. The demand that all the surfaces of an object be represented in a single plane again goes straight back to the left hemisphere's tendency to represent things schematically. There is a deliberate emphasis on fragmentation and of simplification into regular shapes of cylinders, cubes, or spheres, which the left hemisphere prefers. Viewed from a neurological standpoint, modernist art and postmodern art appears to mimic the world as it would appear to someone whose right hemisphere was inactivated. Many movements in modernism could be seen from a neuropsychological point of view as a catalogue of left hemisphere modes of apprehension. To remind, this is not a value judgment on the individual works of art produced, merely a reflection on the process that has affected our view of the world during the modern period. Another very concrete example, just like cubism, is that of pointillism. This ultimately reduces gestalt figures to a mass of discrete particles. through a series of discrete dots. This is the way the left hemisphere, for example, represents continuous flow. Absurdism and surrealism expresses total disjunction and random juxtaposition and the emptying out of any meaning. As will be remembered, the left hemisphere has an advantage in processing such non-gestalt and meaningless phenomena. Abstract painting, similarly, favours left hemisphere processing. Collage represents the concept of the whole as composed of independent pieces. And finally, minimalism emphasizes the simple forms, which are also preferred by the left hemisphere. Further analysis can take this conversation even to the transformation of music, but that's not what this video is specifically about. So I think I'm going to wrap things up here. I find this topic of discussion very interesting, so I hope you enjoyed it. Comment your thoughts down below, create conversation. It'll be interesting to hear your thoughts and opinions on this. Make sure to like, comment, and subscribe. If you are feeling extra generous, you can support the channel by donating to my Patreon. Links will be in the description and comments section below. Thanks for watching.